Hey guys, welcome back to the lab number 6. This video, we're gonna be reviewing our sand cone test. This is our sand cone. It's just a way to determine the density of the soil in the field. So to determine the unit weight, and of course this is used to then find our relative compaction and compare to our max density that we get from the lab. So the materials for this lab are pretty straightforward, and the procedures are pretty straightforward, and a lot more less sketchy compared to last week's Atterberg lab. So in this lab, we're basically just using weight and mass and density volume relationships to find the volume of a hole. So to do that, we use our sand cone. This is our sand cone. That's the cone. There's sand inside of it. And we can find the density of the sand in the sand cone. And then we can find the mass that's required to fill the hole with sand outside. And then by knowing the density of the sand and knowing the mass that's required to fill the hole, we can then find the volume of that hole and then correlate that to the actual density of the soil outside. So first thing we need to do is calibrate our sand cone and determine the density of the sand that's in this cone. So to do that, we are using our Proctor mold. This is our Proctor mold. It's 1/30th of a cubic foot, or 944 cubic centimeters. So we know the mass of this by itself. That's that value right there. So write that value down. We'll then fill it up with our sand that's in this cone. Then by subtracting out the weight of the collar by itself, or the weight of the mold by itself, we can get the mass of the soil that's filled this. We know the volume, so mass divided by volume again is the density, and that is going to be our density of our Ottawa sand, or just any reference sand. And then of course we're going to call that our gamma, or unit weight of our Ottawa sand, and that's what you'll see in your procedures. So once we find the density of the sand just in its free-falling state, we also need to take one more calibration, and we need to determine the volume, or the weight of sand that would fit in this cone. So the way this sand cone actually works, again, this is filled with sand here, and then we have a little valve that opens and closes and lets the sand flow out. So when we're actually in the field, what we're going to be doing is digging a hole, placing this over the hole, and then we'll be opening the valve and letting the sand flow into the hole that we just dug. So the sand is going to fall into the hole. There should be a hole right here, but the sand is also going to fall into the cone. So we need to determine what the weight of the sand is that fills this cone, so we can subtract that out to find the weight of the soil that is actually in the hole. So kind of confusing, but hopefully when you see it, when we go out to the lab or the field, it'll be a little bit more clear. So first we need to take the mass of the sand cone. That is gonna be your W3, so pre-calibration, so it's full. We'll flip it over, open the valve. No, you can't tell, but it's emptying out real quick. Let this run for about a couple minutes, 2 minutes maybe, just make sure everything flows out. Okay, it stopped. Usually you'd have a nice clear glass bulb and you could see when it was stopping the flow. You can't see, it's opaque, so whatever. But you can hear now, it stopped going. So now we'll close the valve here. And I will lift this up. You can see that was all the sand that filled this cone. So now what we need to do is take this mass again. This is going to be our W4 value. W4, there it is. Write that value down. And then of course when we subtract this from our initial W3, then we can find our WC, which is the weight of the sand that's in the cone. So now we need to put this back in, and we are ready to go out to the field and dig our little hole and take our density.
Okay, so we're out in our field now. Now obviously, if this was a real project, we would be doing these sand cone tests in a place where we actually care about the density, right? Like a foundation or a roadway or some type of construction site. We wouldn't be doing this here at, like, behind the old skate park at UNF. But same thing, right? We have our compacted soil and we need to find the density of this little soil pack that I just spent compacting for the past 15 minutes. So to do that, we have our little template, and this template is the same diameter as our mold, as our sand cone. So we've already had this compacted. What we'll do now is place this on our compacted area. We'll dig a cylindrical hole approximately 4 inches in diameter. Once we dig that, we'll place the cone on top of it, open the valve, and then remove it and take the mass of our sand cone after all the soil has been dumped into the hole. So this is the hole that we've now dug. And again, it just has to be approximately 4 inches deep. We're actually going to be finding the volume of the hole using our sand cone. So it doesn't need to be exactly, but we need to make sure that it's large enough. We can take the volume, but not too large that we lose all of our sand in our sand cone. So of course, what we have to also do is collect all of the soil that was taken out of our hole. And we need this because we need to know the mass of the soil that was in the hole so we can find the density, because mass divided by density, or mass divided by volume is the density. Now, source of error for this example, there is organics. We have like pine needles, we have a bunch of, like, I don't know what this is, just organic material. If this was an actual construction site, you'd be doing this on fill, like clean soil that was brought into the site, so you wouldn't have these organic issues. So that is gonna skew the volume a little bit off. It's also gonna skew the moisture content because we need to find the moisture content of this soil so we can find the dry density. Because remember, the compaction effort, the density, the field unit weight is shown in dry density. All right, we have our hole. Now we're going to make sure the valve is closed, place our sand cone over the hole. Let's make sure it's lined up. And now we open the valve and let the sand fill our hole. Okay, so we're back from the field now. The first measurement we need to take in the lab post-field visit is the weight or the mass of the soil that was dug out of the hole. So this will be our W hole in the equations. A couple things to remember for this potential source of error. We have some organics in here. There's grass, there's twigs. So the density is not going to be consistent through the whole hole that we just dug. So this weight could be skewed because of the organics in there. And again, if this was a real project site, the soil should be cleared of all organics, all roots, all leaves, all that stuff by the time we're compacting it and by the time we're ready to start constructing on top of it. So the next reading that we need to take is our measurement of the weight of our sand cone after the soil has filled the hole that you just saw. So this is going to be our W6. You can see
it is kind of empty now. We would refill this back up with soil and then be ready to take another measurement. And again, we're assuming that all the soil that left this can or this jar was either in the cone or in the hole that we just dug. So that's how we get the weight of the sand that was filled in the hole. So one of the probably cons of this test is that, if you haven't noticed by now, you can only take one measurement or one spot of density using one cone. So if we wanted to take, like a normal project, multiple measurements of density, not just one, you're of course gonna need a lot more sand cones. So you're gonna be hauling a lot of sand cones out, writing on a lot of sand cones, calibrating all these sand cones, and it's gonna take a lot of time. So unfortunately, there's a lot of travel back and forth, and you can't calculate the density until you bring the sample back to the lab. So that's one of the benefits of what we use called the nuclear density gauge that can actually take measurements in the field without having to come back and take mass weights and all the volumetric relationships like we would for the sand cone. So these nuke gauges are pretty interesting because, again, it's a big shoebox that you're putting in the ground pretty much, and it's taking the measurement of the density right then and there. So whenever you have that data, you can pick up your little box, move it to another spot, and take another measurement, and we don't have to use multiple sand cones because you can probably imagine it takes a lot of sand cones if you have like a long project. You have to take densities every 100 feet or so. So one more thing that I forgot to mention is we need to also take the moisture content of this material. As remember, the density that we're calculating from this mass of soil is moist. So there's water mixed in the pore space here. So we need to express our density in terms of dry density. So we need to find the moisture content. And of course, we need to take the mass of a can, which is here, the mass of the water, or the mass of the wet soil, which is here. And then 24 hours later, through the magic of editing, this is the mass for the dry soil. And you'd use that to find your moisture content. So you can see, easy lab, really basic, really important though, because again, we need to find the density in the field and making sure that all of our calculations in the lab are actually being achieved in the field condition, because that's what really matters. We can do calculations, we can analyze as much as we want in the lab, but if the conditions in the field aren't met to that criteria, then we're not gonna have a sufficient design.